We will be talking about batch modeling. My name is Marie Peterson. I'm the marketing director at Kaymo Software. And with me, I have Heather Burke, who is our chief human nutrition, and she's going to conduct the session today. It will be a session that takes, the presentation should take around 40 to 45 minutes. And after that, we will have plenty of time for questions. We will take the questions at the end, but please feel free to put them into the questions box in the panel, and we will deal with them as we come to the end of the session. I've also put a few handouts for you. There's an article about batch modeling, and there's also one, a data sheet about the product itself, and the slides themselves are also available in the handout section. So without further ado, I'll like to hand over to Heather.
Great, thanks Marie. And thanks everyone for attending the webinar today. So today we're going to talk about our modeling batch processes using a non-time dependent approach. So let me get my slides going. There we go. So just a little bit of background. There are quite a few industries that use batch processing. That's common in pharmaceutical, biopharmaceutical especially, as well as food and beverage, chemical industries, oil and gas. And some of the examples are a fermentation process, drying, mixing, any sort of chemical reaction that has a general start and end point, and just metabolism in general. In an industrial production, you might have some process steps that are continuous. They're always happening throughout your process. And others are batch or a semi-batch process, so that you put it into a system, you start it, and then there's an end point rather than it being continuous. So modeling the batch over time is important for your process development and understanding your processes. So you want to make sure that each batch that you make, are they similar to each other? And can you find a reason why some batches give a good quality product and some give some outside of specifications? So we need to keep track of what's going on during each individual batch. And are there any effects coming in from, say, new raw materials or the different season of the year? Are there operator issues, equipment issues? And if we look at each individual batch and compare them to each other, we're able to look at these kinds of things. So it's important to monitor these batches so that you can take care of your quality control and your event detection during the process rather than waiting till after the fact, and also doing some process improvement. So this is the general approach when we're looking at online batch modeling and monitoring. So this is real time or near real time. So what we do is, to start with, you get a whole bunch of data from batches in history, or maybe you've done a design of experiments to make sure that you're covering your entire range. But you have to start with a certain number of batches to get an understanding. So we analyze that data. This is sort of your explorative phase. So we're going to interpret the variable structure, see if there's any outliers in this case, and once we've decided which batches are our good batches and what we expect under normal circumstances, we build a model based on those, and they're generally called golden batches. So then we store that model so that you can then use it for online monitoring. And so then that's kind of the second step, is you do your online monitoring. So this is when you're going to follow your batch over time. You're going to be able to detect your out-of-spec situations because you already know what the golden batches look like. If you have anything out-of-spec, you can go down, drill down, and find a root cause by looking at residuals and contribution plots, which we'll talk a little bit more about later. And this leads you to being able to take some action. whether you're going to change your process control, get some feedback system, and that feedback system could be an operator is aware of what the difference is and change it, or you can even set it up as an automatic feedback loop if you have the right software setups. So sort of the traditional approach is control charts. Often what you see in many manufacturing processes are going to be univariate plots that have confidence limits. So you have a target value, and then it's usually like three sigmas around that is considered within spec. And you can do this for process parameters. You can do model statistics. So if you've done sort of a PCA, you could do a confidence control chart with scores or residuals, for example, as well as multivariate predictions. So some of the problem with this, though, is that batches are often non-steady state. So what's normal at the beginning of the batch is looks very different than what's normal at the end of the batch. Therefore, you have both your target and your confidence limits change with time. This is not a problem so much in your continuous, because at a certain point in your continuous process, that's always going to be pretty consistent. But when you're doing batch, you've got mixing. So at the very beginning, for example, everything is heterogeneous, and as you start to mix it, it becomes more and more homogeneous. So what's normal at the beginning of the batch is different than what's normal at the end of the batch. Another thing that you have an issue with is often with control charts, you're plotting sample number along the x-axis. So what happens when you have an unequal batch length or the starting point is slightly different? So if we're looking at, say, maybe a fluid bed drying system, if your incoming material is a little bit more wet or a little bit more dry than something before, it doesn't have the exact same starting point. And therefore, it may take a little bit longer to dry or a little bit less time to dry, for example. So these are things that you have to account for when you're monitoring your process. So this is your data structure when we're looking at a batch process. By definition, batch processes are a three-dimensional. So you've got an individual batch. You have your variables that you're measuring. These could be process parameters, or they could be spectroscopic variables, as well as time, because things are going to change over time. And there's three major ways going into this traditionally to analyze the data. So you could use your three-way data cube directly, you could unfold batch-wise, or unfold time-wise, and then you do your multivariate calibration and process charting like we spoke of before. So basically, this is your unfolding. Some options, right? So the first one is just to use a three-dimensional block, understand how everything's going on. We can also do batch-wise unfolding. So that means that each batch has its set. So you've got each time point in the rows here and your variables J across. And then you've got time-wise unfolding. So you've got, you know, start to finish for each batch across the variables. So the problem here we have is that for both three-way modeling and that time-wise unfolding, it assumes that you have the same number of time points for each batch. They have to be exactly the same, or you have to put in some fillers or do some warping, which is a way to work around these things if they're not exactly the same. And you're also assuming that each batch process starts at T0 for each batch, and that the process evolves similarly for each batch, and the endpoint is reached at the endpoint time. And that time is always exactly the same. So in real life, we know that this is not often the case. Even when you've controlled it very well, you might have one extra time point or two fewer time points, for example. So what you can do instead is you could replace time with a maturity index. So if you're doing a chemical reaction, you could look at percent conversion, for example. Or you can use some sort of dynamic time warping. And if you're doing your three-dimensional three-way, you can use a Parafact 2 as a way to get around that. Some of the problems with that is that you you screw with your data a little bit and you can make it seem a little bit more good looking than it really is, for example. Or you might make it look worse than it actually really is. So what we thought about is, well, what if instead of thinking about process time and the time in the way we normally think about it, what if we think instead about chemical or biological time? Right? So if we know what the endpoint should look like, a certain drying endpoint, it doesn't matter if we start slightly wetter or slightly drier if we're thinking about how dry it is in general rather than a traditional timestamp. So this is, again, a summary of some of the challenges and what we see as the solution. So it's not always feasible to control that starting point of a batch process. As I've mentioned a couple times now, if you come in from a fluid dryer in the pharmaceutical world, you can't exactly control how wet that particular product is when it initially comes in. Also, the progress of your chemical reaction or your fermentation might not develop linearly over time. It might use a lot of the catalyst or something at first and be really rapid at the beginning and then sort of slow down midway through and then speed up again, and then a different setting, it might be slower at the beginning and then speed up. So sometimes these are things you cannot actually control. So if you plot your control charts based on sample number or your traditional timestamp, you might falsely reject the batch because it doesn't follow exactly the same path that you're used to. So what we've done is developed this method to estimate your batch trajectory and confidence intervals in what we call relative time. So what this does is it removes the dependence of the process time axis. It allows you to visualize how the process evolves independently of the sampling rate, and it enables a plot of individual variables as well in this relative time. So here's some of the various scenarios that I've talked about. So we've got our new approach, the time-wise approach, and batch-wise. And you can see if you have a scenario where all batches are linear and they have a common start and end point, it really doesn't matter which approach you use. They all work just fine. If you want a model that shows scores for your individual samples, that works fine if you're using our approach or you're using a time-wise unfolding, but your batch-wise unfolding does not allow you to do this at all. Ours approach is the only one that does not require an equal batch length. Both time-wise and batch-wise require this. And if you have historical batches that have various relative times, then our approach handles this, and you can handle it sometimes with your time-wise or your batch-wise, but you have to do some sort of warping, and the type of warping that you decide to apply can be a little bit fuzzy, what's the appropriate way. And then two things that we handle that nothing else does is if you have your new batch shows nonlinear behavior. So if you have a process that is progressing, something happens and you have to hit the emergency stop and it's just sitting there for a little while, it doesn't show any actual progression in our models, and it says that it's sitting fine where it stopped, and then it will pick up when you press go again. And also, let's say further down the line, you realize that, hey, I don't have to sample my temperature every 5 seconds. It's okay if we only sample it every 30 seconds or so. With our approach, that's absolutely fine, and it handles that. So you can have different sampling rates, and it still works out just fine. So I'm going to give a little tutorial example, just very simple, of heating water. Because everyone can kind of understand that. So if we take this example that we can all understand clearly, it makes the approach to modeling it make a little bit more sense. So we want to heat some water to 100 degrees, but we've got four different locations. We're going to start, we've got Puerto Rico. Our water temperature is 35 degrees. This is all going to be in Celsius. In Sydney, your water temperature is more like 27 degrees. In New Jersey, you've got room temperature at 20 degrees, and Oslo in winter is you've already got snow is really what you're starting with. Okay. Now, if we plot these in the traditional sense, if we plot them on sample number or time, similar here, it looks like they cannot be compared directly, right? Because what happens is we've got different starting points. And so this one at 35 reaches the endpoint much more quickly when you're looking at sample number. And if you compare with our snow here, it follows a completely different shape than the other ones because we've got a transition from our frozen water into our liquid water before it can actually heat up and get to the boiling point. So if we compare them directly, then they just cannot be compared. You are not able to put control limits around this. You could use dynamic time warping to make the curve similar, but that's really not the best approach to do this. So if we take our fundamentals and we realize that, hey, there is a physical and chemical property to heating up water. So this is the general path that water takes. When it's in ice, it is warming up to a certain point, and then it takes a certain amount of energy and time for the ice to melt. And then once all the ice is melted, then the water can heat up again until it is boiling, and then it's transferring all over into steam. So this is the general path, the change in temperature as a function of time to heat to 100 degrees. So what can we do? We've got our different starting points. So we lay them all on top of each other. So the blue one here is going to be the Oslo that's starting as snow. And then we've got the New Jersey, Puerto Rico, and Brazil, I think it was. And as you see, if we plot them along the line, we can see that, hey, they actually do follow exactly the same path. They just have different starting points along this general path. So what we do is when we want to model this, we find a place that has a common start point. So this is the place where all four of these batches of heating water begin, and this is where they all have a common end. So this is the area of this process that has a common trajectory. So this is the part that we are actually able to model consistently. And that's what we build our model off of, is this area. So here's a walkthrough through the procedure. So the first thing that we do is center and scale the data, and then perform a principal components analysis on all the samples, and you validate across the batch to make sure that you have the optimal model dimension. This means if I have six or seven batches, for example, I would take six of them and use one of them as cross-validation, and hold out one at a time to validate across each batches. So you build an entire batch or a couple of batches out to see how the model performs when you're re-predicting. We're going to look for this optimal grid resolution. So if we look in here, this is our large grid. We're going to break this up into chunks and model the little chunks along the way. When you break that into those chunks or those grids, you find the samples that are inside those grids, and you make a PCA just within those grids, and you recenter and scale from the original data, and this lets you estimate your means for those samples inside those grids based on the new model. And so basically you have little individual models across the whole batch that have their individual moving targets along the way, so that as the shape changes, you're able to make a moving trajectory. So then you update the model with the remaining samples. You make sure there aren't any outliers, and you calculate the trajectory and deviation by interpolation. And then we calculate the main PCA projection results, our trajectory distance, distance to the model, and relative time. So let's see this in a visual way. So here is just an example of a process that's going on. I believe the starting point is up here and the ending point is down here. And we're doing a grid search. So we say, okay, here's a grid that has some samples in it. Let's build a little PCA on that so we can get our hoteling T-squared distances as well as our residuals that exist for that spot. And then we have the next spot. And we do this for each of these grids along the way. So you have a moving mean. All right. So there's a particular advantage during the monitoring phase is that because it's independent of sampling rate, you can show the progress in relative time, and nonlinear behavior is handled, right? So if it starts moving forward and goes back and then goes forward again, that is absolutely handled in the score space. And what we do is we actually follow this batch over time in that score space, and it allows us to detect our out-of-spec situations based on trajectory model distance, distance to the model as a whole, and our contribution plot. And this allows you to take action with process control or feedback system. So I'm just going to give a couple of examples with slides, and then I will actually show how this is done in the unscrambler as well. So in this case, we've got in fluid bed dryer operation. There's three historical batches. We're using inline spectroscopy of near infrared with 193 variables. We run a PCA on the three batches and build our batch model for that, and then project for one new batch. So if we build our PCA model, this is what they look like. So we realized that here is where our batches overlap for our common starting point for all three batches, and this is our common ending point through time. And you can see that the moisture level is not exactly the same between batches. So these probably came in a little bit wetter. This one came in a little bit drier. And in this particular case, they went for a certain amount of time, and as you can see, the ones some of them that started drier maybe got overdried at this point, where they really should have stopped back here at this common endpoint. So we want to take a nice approach to that. So we're taking a look at our loadings as well. Again, we're trying to figure out drying, and we want to make sure that, yes, the loadings are completely interpretable. They make sense. Both of these loadings for PC1 and PC2 show a moisture peak at the 1930 nanometers, so that we trust that this is a two-component model for monitoring moisture. So this is what the trajectory model looks like. We found this black line is the mean trajectory for our three models, and then our three batches, and then we've got our 95% confidence limits around it. And you can see that these limits are changing as we're going through the space. Sometimes they're a little bit tighter to this line, and sometimes they're a little bit wider. And it's all based on the variation between the batches at those specific points. Now, if we just projected our scores on PC2 by sample number, what you see is that batch 3 dries very quickly, right? It's ending a whole lot sooner, and it looks like it's a completely different path than what the two other batches look like. However, if we look at it in our relative time, as we are doing in this case, we can see here's our common starting point. What you see is that because some of them start a little bit wetter than, say, the green one, so it just sits at zero for a little while until it starts moving in the relative time space. And if something is happening more quickly, basically the points take larger jumps between each other. And if they're happening more slowly, so here you can really see that you've got the red and blue dots are very close to each other towards the end of our batch, where the green dots are taking much larger jumps in between the samples. So again, we can take a line plot from our original data. So we can actually also use this to build a model and go back to our original variables. And if we plot our moisture peak in sample time, right, then what we see is that we've got very different shapes between the three different batches. However, if we plot them in relative time from our modeling, we see that they follow very nicely and closely together when we follow it in that path. So that's a big advantage of this approach. So when I predict a new batch on here, so this is a new batch in here, what happens is it's even a much higher moisture coming in. Nothing's happening, it's just sitting there for a little bit, so probably the fluid bed dryer is just churning away, but it's not actually drying. The air is just flowing. And when it's actually started and going on, we see this big jump. It says, oh, okay, now I'm moving forward. I'm going through my space. We can see here where things start to get out of spec, and you can use your control to say, oh, let me tweak things a little bit to bring it back into spec. And see how it goes over time. Again, this is a historical batch at the moment, so it obviously went out of spec here. It was not brought under control, but if this was a real-time monitoring, then you'd be able to be aware that, hey, it's starting to come off of the trajectory. I can make some adjustments for that. So again, this is our score plots. If I look at my scores based on my sample number, we see there is a long time of no projection. And again, if you plotted these versus the original batches, the golden batches, you'd say something's really wrong with this situation. But when we look at it in relative time, we see that it's actually just fine. It just kind of hangs down here. It says we're not at the common starting point yet. We're not actually in control at this point. But once it gets into the space where you're in control, then you're able to take control and do your feedback. We can also look at our model distance over time, so we can see that our model distance, there's no specs for it before the common starting point at zero, and we've got our moving limits for this, what's acceptable for our model distance. And we can see sort of to the end here, it got a little bit out of whack. And we could drill down and use our residuals and loadings for this particular plot to see what's going on here, which factors are causing that to be different than our original batches. We also look at our residual descents to say that those are all good, so our residuals here are fine, everything's under the line here, and you can see that we have adjustable residuals as you're going through your relative time. At some points it's very low, and other times it's allowed to be a little bit higher because there's more variation that's happening in those areas. So here's another example case. We've got a chemical reaction. So we have four historical batches, PCA validation across the batch, three variables of temperature, two temperature points, and a pressure point, and then we're going to project a new batch. So this is what our four historical batches look like. You can see when we do our PCA, they follow a very similar trajectory. This is the starting point, and this is the ending point. So we run our first pass, we get our trajectory. We've got our solid black line that shows our average path, and our dashed lines here show the 95% confidence intervals. And you can see at the beginning here, they're much tighter than, say, in the middle here. And there's even a point here, on, especially this red batch, you see that it progresses forward for a little bit, and then it sort of backtracks in our score space and then moves forward again. But because it's still within our model specifications, there's nothing wrong with that particular batch. It's just taking a non-linear path through that space. This is what this would look like on your screen, and then you could project your new batch through it. You could get these points individually. This is at the end, obviously, but you can see it comes in and it's not quite at this common starting point. And once it pulls in, then you say, okay, now I'm going to start monitoring, do my feedback control. And we can see here where it really diverges away. It gets way out of spec. And you said, oh no, what happened? It looks like something is off. Maybe it was one of the pressure got too high. So someone could go in and adjust the knob and bring it back. So that it would be in spec. And there's a couple of spots where that happened. And then there's a spot here on the right-hand side where it makes a big jump, and then it sort of slows down, sort of stalls out for a little while, but it's still making projection, and this model completely handles that, controlling it. So here's our summary. The new approach models the relative time, and new batches are also monitored in relative time. You're not projected as sample number or process time at all. We can also show our individual variables in relative time to see how they're going over time. And because of this, there's no need to force the batches to a common length. There's no need to warp the individual variables, which we feel is not the correct approach in the first place, because it's not a true understanding of what's happening, what's really happening. This allows you to model what we call the maturity index, because your relative time gives that maturity directly. A one-dimensional representation of your batch trajectory has dynamic confidence limits, intervals. It's a compact way to visualize for the operator. So they really only have to look at that score space And then if you have an experienced user, they have access to those scores, the distance to the model, the residuals and contribution plots, which can be used to identify root cause analysis, why this is happening. All right, so that is the end of the slides that I have. So I want to show at least one example in our software directly so you can see how this will work, how to actually mash the buttons, as we say in the South. So I'm going to show a chemical reaction first, just because it's a little simpler to understand. So in this particular one, we have a number of batches, and we have what is our reactant, we have an intermediate, and then we have our product. And so we're measuring the concentrations of all three of these things throughout the batch time. So I have this set up so that we've got a number of batches and what our variables are, intermediate. So very straightforward. I'm going to go under tasks and analyze batch modeling. So to start with, we have to do a first pass batch model. This is your general principal components analysis to make sure that you identify the right rank order of your model to start with. So I'm going to use this data, and I'm going to use all three of my variables. And I'm just going to build this off of batches 1 through 3. Maximum components is 3 because I only have 3 variables. So under next, I'm allowed to choose my batches, and you see that I have my batch ID here as a category variable that allows me to separate which batches out, and it allows you to do your cross-validation through the batches, which is important for this approach. Next, I am going to weight everything by subtracting the mean and divided by the standard deviation. I can choose different ways of validation. So you might have a couple of separate batches that you're going to use as your test matrix, but in this case, we're just going to cross-validate across the batches that we have. And then there's a couple of options for your algorithm. If you have any missing values, you would use NEPALS, but SVD, or if you have a really large amount of data, it's faster to use NEPALS, or we can use the exact algorithm of the SVD. And I'm going to finish, and this is what we get. So we can take a look at things. Let me take a look at my loadings and put my labels on here. So we can see that we're starting here. We have, this is most important for high values of the reactant. So this is actually the beginning of your process. Your intermediate is down in this corner when that one's high, and then all the way to the right is when you have a high value for your product. And we see that we are capturing almost 100%. We've got 98%, 99% of our variation is captured in two principal components. So this is clearly a two-component model. And we can see that all three of these batches follow a very similar shape. And as you see, you know, the blue one here, it's kind of zigzagging all over the place. There's a lot of variations in our scores as we go, and there's a lot more data points as compared to batch 3, which is the red lines here. It's much more stable, but it's following the same general path, but it's happening a little bit more quickly. So once I've built my first pass model, I go back to tasks and do analyze batch modeling again, and now you can see we can use our trajectory model. And we have a new option here that says which model do I want to use, and in this case it's my batch first pass. You can choose the number of components the software suggests two, which I've already concluded that yes, it should be two, but you can always adjust that if you decide you need more or less components from there. And then we go to next. Again, you're going to check your batch selection, so but we're just going to use all three of those again. But if you found in your first pass that one of your batches is completely out of whack, it's clearly an outlier, you could remove that here just by deselecting it. But these are all good batches. It automatically applies the weights. We can recheck our validation. Again, it's cross-validated. Algorithm's going to be exactly the same. And now here's some of your advanced things. I'm just going to leave everything as default, but you can determine how you want to interpolate your trajectory, if you want it linear, cubic spline, how many ranges you want, how much of the batch coverage, so how many of your data points do you require to be within a grid to be considered a good model, and what your grid resolution is going to be. So you can change the size of your grids. But again, that's a very that's your advanced stage if you want to get into that. But you do have those options. And then we say finish. And now it looks very similar, except now we have our mean trajectory and our limits. And across the top here, I could turn those batch scores off so I could look at just what the trajectory looks like itself. Or my batches, I can also turn the trajectory on and off. Lots of options for you there as well. If I want to turn my legend on, I can see what everything means as well. If we take a look at our residuals, we see that we have our moving targets or acceptable limits, and we can see this red one in this case is a little bit out of spec in this middle part. It's just behaving a little bit differently. And so that's your model. You can go through and take a look at your loadings. Again, put my labels on there. This is pretty much the same as before, except now we have our statistical limits on them. Well, that's all great. We've built our model. Now how do I use it? Okay, so if I go under tasks, I can do predict and batch projection. So I need to choose the model that I want to use. Again, I only have one for the batch trajectory. I'm going to use that same data in my model. Make sure to use the variables. And in this case, I'm going to plot batch 4. Auto pretreatment, if you had any pretreatment applied to this in spectroscopic data, you might do some sort of normalization or a derivative that would all be applied automatically. And then you can set up some alarms for your outlier limits as well. So you can set warnings and alarms for both residuals, leverage types, scores even, so you can set that all up how you want it. And I'm going to do finish, and we see how our new batch falls in line. And we can see this particular one, yes, it falls very nicely within this space, and then it went a little bit longer than it should have, and goes out of space. So in this case, if we had plotted this real time, we'd be able to know, hey, right here, we hit the end of the batch, we can stop our process, and that can save your company time and money, and sometimes products, because sometimes if you leave it for too long, then you wind up with bad product. So let me just do one more with our predict batch projection. This time I'm going to choose sample 5. And if you notice on here, we can see there's a lot, very different data points, right? So batch 5 only has 43 data points, where some of the other ones had as many as 200. So that really highlights the fact that the agnostic to the actual real time. We're going to finish. And we can see here batch 5 was way out of spec when it started, and a lot of really strange things happened going on here. So you probably want to go and look at this batch and say, what the heck went wrong? Let me fix this, and we can say, I know this is a bad batch. And you can even put in something that you know is a bad batch just as a test to make sure that your bad batches would be giving you alarms like this one would be. So that is that example. And I think that's actually pretty good for timing. And I'll send it over to Marie for questions.
Thank you so much, Heather. That was a great introduction and overview of what you can do in our batch modeling and plugin. So we're going to take a few questions. Yeah, you might leave the summary there if anyone and
oh, the summary. Okay. I'll
yeah,
put it at the
and you can just shift to if we need to go back to any slide to demonstrate
sure.
What we want to talk about. So one of the things people are typically asking about is, you mentioned a few of the applications for batch modeling, but what are the most common ones that you've seen so far since we launched this product in July?
Yeah, so I would say traditionally pharmaceutical has done most everything in a batch process. So that has been a very large one, whether it's blending or flu bed dryer type approaches. That's been very common. I can also see it being used in, say, a brewing situation, right? So we have some customers that make beer, for example, and watching the fermentation of their beer. That's one. And then any sort of chemical place, I would see anything that, you know, has these batch processes, right? So those are kind of my top three, I would say, at this point.
Right. So what another important question to many customers is the key improvements. I know you mentioned a few of them, such as product quality, but what are the other things that the customers are looking for to improve in their processes?
Well, a lot of it is really just having that real-time understanding of what's going on with the process. That's sort of a push in a lot of industries, because a lot of times, if you're doing a batch, I mean, you have your settings that you set, but you don't really know what's going on in your process until after the fact. And so you're doing your quality assessments after you're already done. And if it passes, awesome. If it doesn't, then you have to throw it all away. So one of our pharmaceutical companies, they were doing a biologics, right? And there's a lot of fermentation in that. You're growing E. coli, for example, to make your vaccines, for example, and it takes weeks, right? And so if you wait till the end of 2 weeks and all of a sudden you have to dump this $2 million batch, that's no good. But if you can monitor it as it's progressing and you can see where it's starting to go out of spec, you can make adjustments and you can save batches that you would normally have to throw away.
Yeah, I think that sounds like a really important benefit that customers could achieve.
Mm-hmm.
And so you've been out on the field talking to a lot of customers about this. So in your opinion, what's the thing they get most excited about?
Well, they really get excited about the relative time, actually, because no one else has really approached it that way, and not having to warp things. So they don't have to adjust. I think one of the things is if you change sampling rates, because that just happens sometimes. They decide, hey, we don't want to monitor this. We don't have enough space to hold all the data to monitor every second for this data. We want to move back to like every 2 minutes and to be able to use a model that you built on a different sampling rate is really nice. And again, the real time is really huge.
Great. Thanks, Heather. That's a good wrap up with some questions, and it kind of summarizes the whole session today.
Yeah.
So thank you so much for that, and thanks everyone for attending. We have if there's anything you want to add, Heather, to this, or do you feel?
No, I say if you have any questions, you can always email me at hbrooke, B-R-O-O-K-E, at kmo.com. I'm happy to entertain any questions you have after the fact as well.
Yeah, that's perfect. As I mentioned, we are recording the session, so we'll distribute that afterwards and make it available. We have some handouts for you that you can download in the session today. Heather has also previously done a demo video if you want to review that again. The other thing we can do for you, if you have a case and you do want to try this out, we can provide a trial of the software as well. So please contact us at KMO or Heather directly if you like, and we will make sure you get to try this new exciting solution. So thanks, Heather, and thanks everyone, and this concludes the session for today.